I'd like to share today this theme. God cares about justice. God cares about justice. When studying and preaching on the Hebrew scriptures, we often reference the eras when the children of Israel were in captivity, in exile, Babylonian captivity, and then held ultimately captive by the Persians. And when the people were in exile, the ceremonies of the temple ritual that they did in their homeland could not be carried through, and so other religious forms were sought to take their place. Fasting was one of them. And though fasting was a common religious practice throughout the history of the Hebrew people or the children of Israel, as one theologian says, the exile systematized it. And so in post-exile, the people, they brought these ceremonial fasts with them, and they thought that this spiritual practice would attract divine favor. The people of Israel, they saw themselves as trying to walk with God. They were devout in their religious practices of worship and prayer and fasting. Their piety is first rate. And through all of this, though, it is obvious that they have seen no divine changes in their individual lives and in their communal life. And so they bring their disillusionment to God. They pose a couple of questions. Why do we fast and you don't look our way? Why do we humble ourselves and you don't even notice us? What's the use? Questions really suggest a purely formal attitude, a religious quid pro quo, if you will. In essence, Holy One, we have kept up our end of the covenant, but we haven't heard a peep from you. We are living off the promises you made to previous generations, yet we remain faithful. And then God answers. Through the prophet Isaiah, school of Isaiah, God responds, "You call this a fast? Here's why I don't answer. You are fasting but exploiting others. You are quarreling and gossiping and bickering and fighting amongst yourselves. You're trying to impress others with your holiness and you want me to congratulate you." One theologian says that their fasting is an external exercise. God says, "You want to fast? Fine, but this is the fast that I want you to choose. This is the religious discipline that I want you to commit yourselves to. It's a different kind of fast, a fast from all injustice and oppression. You want to abstain or deny yourself from something as a spiritual practice? Fine, abstain from oppressing others." Notice in the text that God doesn't speak in the abstract. Isn't it true that sometimes there is no grip on the conscience with a spiritual or religious attitude that speaks in theoretical and abstract terms? You know what I mean, something like, we are called to be good people. You know, just be a good person. Let's have a peaceful world. No, God says, let me be specific. I need you to be concerned and show concern for those who are suffering. Feed the hungry, visit the lonely, clothe the naked. Don't wait for others. Wake up in your compassion. Rouse your compassion. Rouse it from its slumber. It's in you. I put it there. Go on and step into your compassion and show up on behalf of the poor, the hungry, the outcast, and the homeless. And when you do these things, the righteousness of God is upon you, and then you are that good person. You have planted seeds of peace. Amen. Prophet Paul is as contemporary as if it were written yesterday. Jim Wallace is insightful here, telling us that Isaiah understood that feeding folks who are hungry, working for fair housing, advocating for a just wage instead of a minimum wage, mentoring young folk, pushing for health care for all people, extending mercy to someone who is outcast, whatever it may be, Isaiah understood that it's not the healing of those troubled, weary, and downtrodden people that's at issue. It's our healing that's at issue. And you can count on it. We will be healed because God shows up, friends. The text is clear. Break those chains of injustice wherever you see them. Give the oppressed their freedom. I have provided enough. You don't have a resource problem, you have a distribution problem. So feed the hungry, show mercy to the homeless and poor. And if you do these things, notice the text in verse 8, God doesn't say, maybe things will get better. No, no. God says, then your light will break forth like the dawn. And your healing shall spring up quickly. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. Regard everyone as your neighbor. Love your neighbor as yourself. Then you shall call and God will answer. You shall cry for help and God will say, here I am. Here I am. God's healing will make the rounds when our inner self-work is fuel and spiritual energy to participate in God's plan for humankind and the earth, and we will all be whole. See, sisters and brothers, it turns out that God cares about justice. It turns out that the one who is unlimited love is not just concerned about whether we can recite certain creeds, whether we have stellar attendance at church. God is not just concerned about getting us all into heaven in the great by and by. The one who has created all of us is concerned about how all of us are walking in the world here, now, today. In the book, Space for God, Don Postema, he says, the spiritual life is not hidden inside us. It's practical. It affects everything we say and do. It's bigger than our traditions and rituals. Living in the presence of God, being in touch with God's spirit, being fine-tuned to God's sensitivities, involves us in reflecting God's concern for all people. In fact, the Old and New Testaments indicate that you can tell a person's relationship with God by looking at his or her relationship with other people. This is what the disillusioned people in this text didn't understand. Prayer, fasting, worshiping, and the spiritual life, you see, are not an escape from life, but a confrontation with life. Prayer and the spiritual life, you see, are not an escape from life, but a confrontation with life. Lord have mercy. The old Negro spiritual speaks to us here. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land, and tell old Pharaoh, anybody know him? Let my people go. Like Moses, the church is called to face and confront Pharaoh and bring God's message of liberation that all would be free. God says, go on down to those systemic and institutional pharaohs and tell them to let my people go. Church, go on down and confront the social conditions that have allowed 925 million of my children to go hungry in this world. Go on down and tell Pharaoh to lift the boot of iron boot of oppression and poverty from my people. Let my people go, God says. Our spirituality must include care and concern for others. My life's journey with God has everything to do with my life's journey with you. Like so many others, the election cycle has had me just wringing my hands. I have been surprised at the level of anxiety that I am carrying in my body and mind because of the bitter, vitriolic discourse in our politics. Do I have a witness today? And then to talk to folks across the political spectrum who are also wrestling with anxiety and anger and even sadness. God's heart was broken because the people had normalized injustice, had given legitimacy to the point that their pursuit of the holy, their seeking of the divine through spiritual disciplines and practices didn't pierce their conscience. The exploitation of workers, taking advantage of the powerless, the bitterness and bickering and quarreling function right alongside their spiritual practices. Like the children of Israel, in our text, there has been the normalization of injustice in our nation, especially in this election season. Sadly, there has been the kind of normalizing of hate speech, violence and intimidation, pitting groups of folk against each other. Like the Hebrew nation in our text today, we are devout in our practices in various ways as well. These not-so-United States of America often tout the idea that we are a Christian nation, unfortunately and unfairly dismissing the vast religious pluralism in this nation. Amen. The many ways that we come to the divine. But devotion to God is one of our shining examples of our greatness. But in our worship and spiritual practices, injustice lives and functions right alongside our devotion. For we cry, Lord, Lord. We cry, Lord, Lord, as gun violence escalates and some fight against gun regulation. We cry, Lord, Lord, as illegal immigrants in this country experience dehumanization of their being on a daily basis. We cry, Lord, Lord, as black and brown communities still experience the over-policing of their communities. I know about it. We cry, Lord, Lord, as refugees cry for a home on the rough seas. We cry, Lord, Lord, as indigenous peoples in North Dakota, God have mercy, at Standing Rock, like their ancestors, are fighting to preserve land and water against the Dakota Pipeline. And we are crying, Lord, Lord, as we continue to breathe the smog air of racism and sexism and misogyny and homophobia and transphobia and ableism and ageism and on, we cry, Lord, Lord, as we incarcerate more people than any other nation on earth. We cry, Lord, Lord, as healthcare is still out of reach for so many. We cry, Lord, Lord, as residents of Flint, Michigan still don't trust their water supply, and many will carry the health conditions caused by lead for the rest of their lives. And we cry, Lord, Lord. And what we're finding out in this text in Isaiah and throughout the Old and New Testament, and you will find it in other sacred texts of other religious and spiritual traditions, guess what? God cares about justice. God cares for the poor and the oppressed, whether we care or not. Like the theologian Peter Paris tells us, God, through the prophet, admonishes that community and us, that we would bring our religious devotion into alignment with the demands of social justice toward all God's people, and especially the least of these, across the racial spectrum. This flies in the face of a privatized religious practice observed by so many that attempts to detach religion and spirituality from social and economic injustice. This call to face injustice, to look at it, name it, stand in solidarity with those under the iron boot of oppression, is ultimately a call to love. In the Gospel of Matthew, some wanted to know what the supreme law was. Someone asked Jesus, Master, what is the greatest commandment? And what did Jesus say? He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all of your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So what we see here is that we don't belong to ourselves, do we, sisters and brothers? We belong to God and one another. We are interconnected. All of life is interdependent. Dr. King told us. The world in which we live is geographically one, for we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I cannot be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. And so ultimately, catch this, we can no longer see the suffering in the abstract. You have a witness today? God is calling on us to bring those who are far off in our minds up close. And when we do this, when we face ourselves, the last phrase of verse 7 in the Hebrew goes beyond calling the poor and the homeless your own kin, as in the English, but it is translated to calling them your own flesh. Oh, sisters and brothers, the Spirit speaks to us and tells us we've got to put some flesh on. When I put flesh on, the scales fall from my eyes and I see clearly the truth of the interdependence of all lives. When I take that amorphous suffering and in my mind give you bone and sinew and muscle and skin, you are no longer they and them. You are me. You are I. Indeed, I can't stand up for the suffering until it's real to me, until I put some flesh on my own flesh, where I see them, where I see others as I see myself, created in the image of God. And when I do this, the millions of suffering and oppressed people around the world, again, they're no longer relegated to they, those people and other. As I close, the theologian Richard A. Floyd, he talks about how love requires reflection and communal reflection at that. He says, this love of God, neighbor, self is not some innate human quality. It is not a natural state for the human animal. The habit must be formed in a grace-filled community, he says, of faith. But I would say a community where it is proclaimed and sung and embodied over and over and over again. We try to walk that in this community. We try. But it takes practice, doesn't it? Tuesday's coming. And I wish I had some profound thing to say about the upcoming election, but I'll leave you with this. Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. God bless you.
Amen.